Well, good evening. I didn't hear you back. Good evening. We have Justice Sonia Sotomayor in the house. I was just thrilled when I got the call from Father John's office that Justice Sotomayor was coming to Notre Dame. First woman justice of color, Latina, and author of My Beloved World, now almost 500,000 books and CDs sold. I was thrilled that she could experience our beloved Notre Dame family and our South Bend community. And I am hopeful that we can become a small part of her beloved world. We need to thank my fellow trustee, Jose Fernandez, for getting her here, Anne Thompson for being here, and Justice Sotomayor for saying yes. She is a phenomenal woman who says yes to courage, challenges, leadership, giving back, opportunities, equal justice, yes to family and friends. And I'm honored to be your moderator this evening. My name is Anne Claire Williams, and I sit on the board of trustees, and I'm a Notre Dame law graduate. But I'm here tonight because the justice and I are sisters of the robe and heart. How did that happen? We first met at Baby Judges School in Washington, D.C. Yes, there is a Baby Judges School, a training school for new federal judges. I was training, and she was newly minted, a brand new judge. And from the beginning, I knew she was a star and would be a great judge. She was brilliant and is brilliant, wise, measured, spirited, confident, funny, scholarly, meticulous, determined, tough, passionate, and I always felt that she would be the one selected for the Supreme Court. I wish I could do as well with the lottery. We became fast friends, bonding as we celebrated over shopping, eating, going to theater, going to parties, but mostly bonding because of the extraordinary blessings we have been given, both from humble beginnings, TV lawyer Perry Mason, the only lawyer we knew, she from the Bronx, me from Detroit, she's on the district court in New York, me in Chicago, both the youngest on our courts, she to the Second Circuit, me to the Seventh, both appointed by Republican and Democratic presidents. She, now at the pinnacle of her career, the Supreme Court, dealing with the most difficult issues of the day. From the beginning, I felt our sister friendship was so special. And then I realized that all who are blessed to know her feel so special, feel that what I call heart connection, a human heart connection, her connection to people of all walks of life, her humility that enables her to treat those who sweep the floors and presidents with the same dignity and respect. So comfortable in her own skin, never ever letting the black robe get in the way of her humanity. Seeing her Greek culinary students in the kitchen taking photos with the student chefs and the servers and the cleanup crew, and then asking those students for their addresses so she could send written thank you notes. How she insists, if she agrees to do any speaking event, that children and young people, particularly students of color, first generation high school, college, law school students, be part of the event. That human heart connection with future generations. And in addition to that human heart connection, she is a dreamer of big, impossible dreams. When asked of how do you hold on to those impossible dreams, she said, experience has taught me you cannot value dreams according to the odds of their coming true. Their real value is in stirring within us the will to aspire. And after time, you recognize that the proper measure of success is not how much you've closed the distance to some far-off goal, but the quality of what you have done today. What incredible quality she has brought to her life, to the court, to America and the world. And I am now so pleased to turn this over to another friend, a connection of the heart, a man who is Notre Dame's dreamer of impossible dreams, who never thought he would be president of Our Lady's University, who stirs all of us with the will to aspire, who moves our Notre Dame and South Bend communities forwards, who has always had at the forefront of his mind a quality, great Catholic education here at Notre Dame, our own beloved Father John Jenkins.
Well, I am so proud and honored to be here. I'm honored to have our alumna and trustee and United States Court of Appeals Justice of the Seventh Circuit, Ann Williams, with us. I'm very honored to have another alumna, Anne Thompson of NBC News, with us. Anne is just extraordinarily generous in coming and helping us out here at Notre Dame for anything we ask, and we're just so pleased and proud to have her tonight. And it's my great, great honor and privilege to welcome our guest, Associate Justice of the Supreme Court of the United States, Sonia Maria Sotomayor. President Obama made history in May of 2009 when he named as his first vacancy to the Supreme Court a daughter of a widowed Latina who grew up in South Bronx, poor in material wealth, but rich in love and intellectual curiosity and acumen. Her father died when she was 9, and her mother worked 6 days a week, often on night shifts, in order to make ends meet while still finding time to instill a love of reading and learning in Sonia and her brother. In selecting his first nominee, the president explained that he searched for an individual with great intellectual rigor and a proper, fair-minded, non-ideologically driven judicial theory. But the president knew that the country required something more in its Supreme Court justice than just exceptional legal expertise. Extraordinary life experiences were needed, the kind that informs legal decisions with hard-earned wisdom and anchors complex legal questions with lived experience of real people. These are the qualities the president first recognized in Sonia Sotomayor. And it has been these qualities that the country has come to recognize and admire in her during the past 6 years of her time on the bench. Her legal expertise has been honed by mastering the most rigorous academic and professional challenges. She graduated summa cum laude from Princeton University, where she was elected Phi Beta Kappa and was awarded the university's highest academic honor. She earned her law degree at Yale Law School, where she was editor of the Yale Law Journal. Before rising to the level of partner at a distinguished commercial firm in Manhattan, Justice Sotomayor served as assistant district attorney in the New York County District Attorney's Office, joining a trial unit that handled everything from misdemeanors to homicides. Her unique talents brought her to the attention of New York Senator Daniel Patrick Moynihan, who in 1991 recommended her to a federal judgeship, boldly predicting that she would one day become the first Hispanic Supreme Court justice. Justice Sotomayor went on to take her seat in the Southern District of New York and later on the United States Court of Appeals. We are extraordinarily honored at Notre Dame to have such an extraordinary person, a justice of the Supreme Court, and a person of the qualities that Justice Sotomayor has. I can tell you personally that it's been just such a delight for me to spend time with such a wonderful and warm person. And now I ask you all to give the warmest, most enthusiastic Notre Dame welcome to our speaker and our moderator, Anne Thompson, and our guest, Anne.
Thank you. Are you Bert Plunt?
I am. I'm, you know, I choked up. Anne Williams, you gotta stop that. And Father John, you just followed suit, but thank you both. That was just heart-touching. Thank you very much.
Well, I want to start by telling you a story.
Go ahead.
Okay? Give you a little chance to collect yourself. So on May 26, 2009, I get a call from the NBC News desk that says, you need to go to the Bronx, and you need to go to Cardinal Spellman High School.
Did you find it?
I did. Amazing. Imagine that. And I don't even think I had Waze then. So
I know you didn't.
So and they said, President Obama has just nominated one of their alumnae, Sonia Sotomayor, to the Supreme Court. So your assignment today is to go out and talk to the kids at Cardinal Spellman High School about the new Supreme Court nominee. So I went out there, and all the TV trucks are pulling up, and for once, we're pulling up to a school, and it's actually good news. And the kids come out, and I start asking them questions, and they didn't quite, the name rang a bell, but they didn't quite know who you were. So go back in, they came out at lunch, they had learned a little more. And what was, and they kept learning more as the day went on. It was fascinating to watch the arc of their knowledge through the day about your life. And I thought about it, and I thought, these kids are living history in real time, learning history in real time. For the past 6 years, you've lived history in real time. So from your vantage point, what does it look like?
Well, for me, that moment of history started that day, the day of my nomination. And what had happened before the speeches is that I was in the back with my family, and the president and vice president. My nephews are talking to the president about soccer. My brother's talking to the vice president about golf. And I'm sort of taking all of this in and not quite there, if that makes any sense to you. It was like I was a little bit distant because it's almost overwhelming. Well, they all left, my family and all the other people, and went into the conference room. And I was left with the president and vice president, and we start to walk out towards the front. And they have much taller legs than I do, and they were walking faster. So I leaned in and I said, please, please, slow down. And they both simultaneously turned around, and they both smiled at me. At that moment, I felt like my spirit left my body. I was looking at myself from up there. That's what it felt like. I couldn't connect with my emotions, and I knew ultimately, that the reason for that was that if I did, I wouldn't be able to do what I needed to do, to give a speech. But I thought it would end at that day. Well, it lasted for about a year and a half. No, seriously, I watched myself doing things that I never imagined would be possible. Now, I could talk about, and I will, sitting in the Supreme Court on John Marshall's chair to take the oath of office, staring across from me, and there's the president and vice president looking at me. That moment was literally surreal because I couldn't imagine it was happening. I go back to the reception, and in the reception are people whose names I had only heard of, like Ricky Martin, whom a friend had.
Did he do a little live in La Vida Loca?
A month later, I get invited by then Mark Anthony and Jennifer Lopez to their home. And she's telling me about Jennifer Lopez is telling me about her mother and her friends who happened to be home on the 26th and how they had listened to my nomination. And inside of me, I'm listening to her talk and I just can't imagine it. When you're in this surreal state, it's not real. I keep telling people that I thought that someone should pinch me to wake me up. A couple of months later, I throw out a first pitch in Yankee Stadium. I get to sit on a historic case during argument. My first was Citizens United. Wow. And for the non-lawyers in the room, that is the seminal case that has launched the campaign financing, the new campaign financing regime of this country. It's a historic, historic big case. Mm-hmm. And I was part of that conversation. And when you're in it, you're involved in it. You're not thinking about this as history, not history. You're trying to convince, persuade, trying to have your perspective, listen to, hoping that it will change someone's mind. And when it doesn't, being disappointed. Occasionally, when you're a part of the conversation and you do change someone's mind, it's incredibly gratifying. One of the things about being a justice is even when we lose, we can express our views in dissent. So you're a part of history in that way. But when you're in it, at least for me, I'm not thinking about being a part of history. I am part of what is happening to better our jurisprudence, to better an understanding of law in the country. And you hope that it'll be understood and accepted, but you don't always know. And you live it for the moment, because you can't but live it for the moment.
You've been, you know, I thought about what would my opening question be, and I thought, what did you do this summer? Because this court has had an extraordinary summer. I mean, just monumental decisions. And I think one of the things that I'm interested is, how do you reach those decisions? Is it just that you write and you pass papers around? Or do you say, you know, Antonin, let's go down and get a cup of coffee at Starbucks and I'll treat to the soy latte. Or Tony, let's go have a glass of wine. I mean, how
I would reverse those things.
Oh, really? How much is personal interaction and how much is paperwork?
A lot of the initial decision-making is personal interaction. Generally speaking, the first time that we get to talk about a case is during oral argument. The lawyers get up and start making their arguments, but you have to understand that we know what their arguments are because they've submitted briefs. And if they fail to raise a point in their brief, they forfeit it. And we won't consider it, because you have to raise every issue, first in your cert petition, the request to ask us to hear the case, but then in your brief, for sure, you have to argue the point. If you don't, you've lost it. And so it's not as if they're coming to a cold bench. They're coming to what is a very hot bench. Because we've read the briefs, we've studied the law. For some of us, they've been making the law, yeah. Meaning the precedents, not making laws in the sense of statutes, but the precedents were written by many of my colleagues. And so they know it intimately. But we're coming to explore what each other is thinking. And that's what a lot of lawyers don't understand. Through our individual questionings, our colleagues are understanding each other. We're exploring the strengths and weaknesses of the case through our questions. And we are, in a form, trying to convince each other either that a strength overrides their hesitations or that their hesitations don't have validity in the record. But we're trying to convince each other. It is a conversation not just with the lawyers, but among us. And that's really the first talk we're having about what each is thinking. But that conversation is not about how we're going to vote. It's about the strength and weakness of the case. So sometimes you'll listen to an oral argument and you'll get a clear idea of what's troubling a particular justice or justices. But sometimes you'll see us asking hard questions of each side. And that's because we are exploring and touching the weaknesses and strengths of each side. The next time we get to talk, generally, there is occasionally on the monumental cases, individual judges may confer before the vote, but that's not that common. More common is that we go from argument, which is either on a Monday, Tuesday, or Wednesday. For the Monday cases, on Wednesday afternoon of that week, we hold a conference, and starting with the chief judge, everybody casts their vote. But in doing so, we have to explain why. So the chief will start, and his is usually the most fulsome explanation. He'll come up and say, look, this is the way I'm voting, or I'm a little bit unsure, this is what's still troubling me. And he'll go down through all the reasons why he's been convinced that this is the position that he should or might take. He also explains why some of the counterarguments don't convince him. What happens is then we go down in descending order around the room and descending order of seniority, and Justice Scalia speaks next. He'll either say, I agree with the chief, but I'm not sold by that argument because I think there's an additional argument that needs to be considered. Or I came to the same place, but by a different route. And so he explains his thinking that way, not repeating anything the chief said, but adding to it or subtracting from it. And everyone does that. By the end of the discussion, we all sort of know what each is thinking. You have an idea of what kind of opinion, if you're in the majority, you have to write to get the votes you need to make a majority. Because you have to know that if Justice Scalia is not sold by an argument, you better frame that argument in a careful way if you're going to include it. Or you have to give it a sort of secondary importance if it's going to be part of your draft. Dissenters do what the chief did. They'll go through why they think the decision should be different, why they're not convinced by the arguments. And occasionally we go back and forth, sort of exploring some of the major points raised by the justices. So what happens then? At the end of the 2 weeks of argument that happen every month, the chief assigns opinions to the justices. Occasionally, people will come in and say, I'm unsure, give me time to write a memo trying to explain better my thinking. Sometimes a couple of people will go back and say, I haven't considered the viewpoint expressed by this colleague. Let's not take a final vote till later in the week. And occasionally, there's individual talking between and among justices, where they go back afterwards and think about it. And yes, we don't often go for a glass of wine together.
Only before the State of the Union.
Exactly. You know, everybody needs fortification occasionally. and remember what our role is, just to sit there. but there is talk, and we do talk. I guess you don't have as a follow-up question, but if you do, you'll skip it, which is, do people ever change their mind? Yes, it happens. Not with great frequency. After that much work and preparation and talk, you pretty much become convinced at some point of your position. But every once in a while, and in my experience, almost every year, a decision flips. A majority becomes a dissent and vice versa.
Can you give us a specific example?
No.
I don't think so. You gotta try.
So she's too much a journalist,
no,
you know?
But here's I think what has been notable especially in this most recent session, is that in some of the writing, and in particular in the dissents, there have been zingers. Like, fortune cookies have been mentioned, hippies have been mentioned. It's sort of makes your eyes pop. And I know that you have said that your colleagues are pugnacious writers, and you yourself have, you know.
Occasionally thrown a zinger.
Yes, thrown a zinger here or there.
I do try to restrain myself, but sometimes you can't help it.
So my question is, and I think people look at the court and think, is the court as divided as the country seems politically? In that, you know, we always talk about the liberal and the conservative wing, and boy, they seem like they're at each other's throats.
If you look at our voting record, and you should spend some time, in the majority of cases, now last year in particular, it was very high. It was like something like 63-67%. We agreed almost unanimously. This year, I think it may have been a little less, but we had lesser cases too, so I don't know what that means. And you'll also see alliances on cases that are unexpected. In one case, the alliance was so unusual that all of the legal newspapers were writing about it, sort of shaking their heads as, how did this happen? We're not, many of us have similar approaches to constitutional interpretation, but the fact that we have similar approaches doesn't always mean we come to a similar result. And there is no one shy on the court about either expressing themselves or who has a failure of courage to vote for a position that's unexpected. I think every justice, and this goes to the fundamental question you're asking, every justice on that court is devoted to the court. Each one of us cares deeply about the court's institutional responsibility to the society. We work very hard when we can in good faith to reach consensus. And the fact that we do as often as we do, I think shows that effort. But we also have a very deep abiding passion about the Constitution, our system of government, about our respect for the law, that leads us to believe that certain things can't be compromised. In constitutional cases in particular, it's very, very hard to do.
You made that very clear in the Michigan admissions
Absolutely.
Case.
You yeah. can't take a position that you fundamentally believe is unconstitutional or not the correct interpretation of the Constitution. But I remember Justice Souter when I succeeded him and took his seat when he retired. And he called me to welcome me to the court. And he said, you know, Sonia, it took me a little while to understand when I disagreed with my colleagues, that every one of them is a person of good intentions. Everyone is a person of good faith. They are really trying to do what they think is right. And that is what I think keeps us friends. And I think that may be missing from the rest of the country, because it becomes personal as opposed to institutional. It becomes personal instead of believing or understanding that someone is saying what they are because they really believe it's the best thing. And what is a dissent? It's someone who lost. And if you lost, you're going to be a little bit more outspoken than the people who won. If you won, it's pretty good, you know? And so there is much, much, much more forgiveness than I think happens in other settings, because we do understand the passion by which we're each driven.
And you're also stuck with each other.
I mean, oh, yes. You know, if you make an enemy for a very long time, you may lose that person in something important.
Yeah.
There was a time when the court was deeply, not this court, but older courts, I mean, I shouldn't say older, courts in past years, who were not friends and were very, very combative with each other personally and professionally. There's a book out, I guess I'm not gonna, but there are books that talk about those tensions. And one day, a group of us were sitting around talking, and one of my colleagues said, when did that stop? What was the catalyst to make the court more friendly with each other? And everybody was throwing out ideas. Someone attributed it to a former chief judge, someone attributed it to something else. And out of the corner of the room, in a very quiet voice, my colleague Ruth Bader Ginsburg said, it's when you started having women. And when I thought about her answer, I remembered that I was told that when Sandra Day O'Connor was appointed, that one among the first things she did was insist that the justices have lunch after every argument and every conference.
And do you still do that?
Yes. And I'm told when she was there, if a colleague missed too many, she would go sit in their office and point out to them.
So what is it, what difference do you think a woman Supreme Court justice makes? Is there something, I mean, obviously all nine of you have great intellectual ability, but what is there a difference that women make?
There have been many, many studies about the impact of gender and race differences on court decisions. And some of those studies do point out to various situations in which the presence of women has changed rulings in a certain way. One of the ways it changed the Supreme Court was that we started actually having cases that supported women's rights. It was only when Sandra Day O'Connor and Ruth Bader Ginsburg came to the court that we had the first case that found race, that found gender discrimination that was unacceptable. And that was the VMI, Virginia Military School case. Before that, the Supreme Court had almost routinely never voted in favor of a woman's issue. And a lot of people don't remember that or realize that. The court might have been a slight step ahead of the society when it came to race inequality. It was 10 steps behind the society when it came to gender inequality. And so I'm not saying that it was only the presence of women, but I do think that the presence of women does change the conversation a little bit. I point out a case often to audiences, the Stafford case. It involved a 13 or 14-year-old girl who was reported through hearsay to the principal had taken an aspirin. And this is a no-drug school. And the girl was called into the principal's office, and without notice to her family, she was strip-searched. And the case came to us on whether that was an unreasonable search and seizure by school authorities. It was a public institution. During oral argument, and I wasn't there, so I'm not relaying anything that's confidential. I was a judge in the lower courts. But the conversation during the oral argument suggested that some of my colleagues thought that this strip search was comparable to women or young girls undressing in a locker room.
Oy.
Yes, you're right, okay? Ruth Bader Ginsburg is reported sometime after the argument to have said, I think some of my colleagues do not understand what it's like to be a 13-year-old girl fighting with her own sense of dignity. And now, did that change the vote in that case? Probably not. I'm sure it had no direct impact. But what it stopped was any of my colleagues attempting to analogize this search to a locker room undressing. And that has value. Because I think if anyone had written that in an opinion, it would have been insulting to young women, or even older women. And so there is a difference in sensitivity, in the way you address things, that happens when you have some diversity on the court.
I know for a lot of our students out here are probably looking at you and thinking, man, I would love to grow up to be Justice Sonia Sotomayor, or to have this composure and this ability to speak. So first of all, I understand that when you went to the Supreme Court the first time, you said your knees knocked so loud you could hear them. You and I share something in common. We both come from mothers who were very bright but didn't have a whole lot of self-confidence. And that can be, as you say, I think you said in your book, congenital.
Yes.
So how, when you feel that sense of panic, when you hear your knees knocking, what do you do? How do you combat it?
For me, it's first taking very deep breaths. And the second thing is that I stop focusing on the panic and I start concentrating on the task in front of me. Because I'm one of those people who, when I panic, what I have to do is to remove myself from the panic inside of me and concentrate on the job I have to do. And eventually, the panic subsides on its own. And all of a sudden, I'm engrossed in the argument, what the lawyers are saying, what my colleagues are asking, and the panic just disappears. That Citizens United case, the world was speculating about, I shouldn't say the world, all the media world was speculating about what would
the
be...
The world was.
Yeah. about what my first question would be. And I have thought of some questions, but I certainly wasn't going to interject them just to satisfy people. And I remember initially being, you know, when should I step in? What should I ask? And wondering about it. And I finally stopped wondering about it, and I realized, you know, I just have to let it flow. And I have to let it come when it feels right. And that's what I did. And the first question came out, and one of my colleagues passed me a note that says, isn't it good to be over that moment?
Yeah, and
you, it was.
And you quite gotten over it, because I read by one account you were the second most vocal justice.
That was
on
only for a year. I've tried to control myself. Recently, I haven't been.
But aside from the conversation of talking to each other, what are you trying to elicit when you ask those questions from the bench?
For me, I want lawyers to convince me. I pose hard questions for them to know what's deeply troubling me. And I want a real answer. I want an answer that'll set me onto a different path. And so for me, it's not a cross-examination with the intent to embarrass someone. It's a questioning for me to understand what argument they're making and how and why it holds up. And so that's generally the nature of my questions. I also like facts, because I am a judge trained in the old school. And the old school of judging, each case was decided on the basis of its facts. And you never ruled more broadly than the facts before you. That's called common law jurisprudence. And that's the way I grew up, both as a lawyer and as a district court judge. But appellate courts are more accustomed to trying to rule more broadly. And I've never gotten accustomed to it. I try to stay more narrow than some of my colleagues.
You said in your memoir, My Beloved World, that you learned a very important lesson in the debate club in high school. That is, in order to prevail, you must listen first.
Yes.
So how do you balance your desire to ask questions and the importance of listening when you're on the bench?
Well, you have listened when you've read people's papers, because they really, as I explained earlier, have put forth their entire argument. And so it is time for them to sort of understand my perspective and to be able to answer those questions to convince me. Because their papers obviously haven't given the answer. And so I think the balance is less than most people think. The arguments are there, they're in the papers. It's in the opinions below, it's in the arguments below, all of which we review. So it's not as if listening is going to explain something that's there.
Right.
We're looking for the things that are not there.
One of the things that strikes me about you is that you have done a lot, I think, to try to lift the veil of what happens in the Supreme Court. You've gone on The Daily Show. You have negotiated between Goldilocks and Baby Bear on Sesame Street. As you said, you've thrown out the first pitch at Yankee Stadium. Why is that important to you? There was a time when Supreme Court justices never spoke publicly, and certainly never appeared on a comedy show. Why do it?
Well, first of all, the comedy show I appeared on to sell a book.
Okay.
So
that's a good reason.
A lot of my media appearances have been on behalf of my book, My Beloved World. Some, like Sesame Street, were not. And you're right, I refereed a dispute between Goldilocks and the Bears, okay? But I used that as a teaching moment, which was to talk to kids about A, what judges do, and B, about how to go about resolving disputes in a way that would help all parties. That's not quite what judges do, but I did want to leave them with a positive impression, okay? Many of my appearances, like this one, are something about making history that I've learned in the last 6 years. The people who are making history are people like you and I. They are ordinary human beings with strengths, with weaknesses, with foibles, with courage, and sometimes fear. When we get disappointed in our elected officials, often it's because we see the human side of them. It's like when you become disappointed in your parents, when you see all of a sudden that they are human, and sometimes that leaves you wanting for that time in your childhood when you thought they were perfect. Well, I want people to realize that those individuals are human beings, and that doesn't mean you should respect them less, but that you should respect them because they're trying to do jobs that are hard. And so in my explaining to you what the process of the court is, what the process of law is, I hope you come away with a respect for the people who are trying their best, human beings trying their best to do what's right. And that doesn't mean that we always succeed according to your judgment, because there are going to be court opinions you agree with, and there's going to be a whole lot you disagree with. But it is a product of people trying to do what's right. And I think that will lead people to less disillusionment, to more respect for the court instead of less, and more respect for people who have the opportunity and try to do the right thing by it.
Throughout your career, people have doubted your abilities because you're a woman, because you're a Latina, whether it was when you went to Princeton, when you went to Yale, when you went to the DA's office, when you were nominated to the Supreme Court. So somehow—
I wasn't smart enough.
You weren't smart enough, yeah.
That's what I was told during the nomination process to the Supreme Court. You worked smarter. It was very
painful. So how do you react to that?
It was hard. You know, I had devoted a career to trying to achieve academic excellence, and I think I did a pretty decent job.
Not bad.
I went to the court, and I was, I thought, and still think, very well respected by my colleagues. And here there are people talking about how I'm just not intelligent enough. And it feels demeaning. And it is hurtful. And for a period of time during the process, I doubted myself and wondered whether I should stay in it. I had said to one of my dear friends, if I leave this process diminished, with people thinking less of me than what I have already accomplished, then what have I won going on the Supreme Court? I've left my dignity behind, and I don't know that this battle is worth it. And I really had a period of doubt.
So what changed your mind?
My friends.
Yeah.
You know? I tell kids, and I guess I don't have to tell kids at this age, college and law school, but I tell kids in grammar school and high schools, choose your friends wisely. You have to choose friends who are trying to do the best, not for themselves, but for you. And those aren't friends who are not naysayers, but friends who will support you when you're down, who will pick up your spirits when they're sort of sailing in the wind, but who are realistic enough to give you the truth when you need it. And I turned to friends who talked me out of my despair.
And what did they say to you? What was the truth they gave you?
What they told me was, look at what you have accomplished. You just got to apply the same formula to the Supreme Court. Throw yourself into it, you'll figure it out. You figured out everything else you've done, you'll figure this out.
And you always break things down to small pieces.
Step at a time. And I went to the Supreme Court and I figured and watched my colleagues. For the first time, I was reading Supreme Court opinions, not for the purposes of understanding the legal theory, but for the purposes of watching how it was presented, how to write an opinion in a more persuasive way. I was watching the arguments and how my colleagues made them in our conferences, and what moved people and what didn't. I'm still not the best at a lot of things, but I have come a long way in 6 years. And I'm still trying to develop myself as a justice. I'm writing shorter opinions. I think each year my page count is diminishing. Occasionally I have a case like Schutte that sets me aback a little bit, a dissent. And I think that my opinions are becoming more persuasive as I learn my craft better.
Do you feel like you belong?
No.
No.
No. I'm very different than my colleagues. You know, I told a group of students today, they love opera, I like jazz. I love Broadway theater, none of them does. I am more outspoken. You said it, more public. As I said to a group of Hispanic students, I'm louder than most of them. There's a little bit of that fiery Latina in me. As you know, I got my colleagues to dance salsa at the end of
That true?
That's true.
Tell that story.
I'm not.
No, come on.
That's already been told by someone else. I wouldn't break the public confidence, but it is true. I am different, and yet I'm not, because we're all engaged in the same enterprise. We're all trying to come to the right decisions together. And we're all, and I am part of that conversation. To that extent, I belong. But will I ever quite feel that I have their same background, their same understanding of the world that I operate in? Not really. Most of my colleagues, not all of them, but a good number of them, were in the federal government on the executive level. I worked on the state level as a prosecutor. They know everybody in government, and I will sit there at lunch hearing them tell stories about what happened to this person in a case 20 years ago when they were a litigator in the government office. Those things make you feel different. But so long as I can keep my eye on the fact that I'm learning a story that's fun to hear and that it may teach me something, then I'm okay. Because I take difference as an opportunity to learn something new about the institution, about the people I'm with, about the situations that I'm facing. For me, it's very, very important not to think of differences as good or bad, but just different, and understanding what moves people to the choices they make. I do go occasionally to the opera, and I actually enjoy it. But I like jazz better.
Well, now you're in for a treat, because I'm going to bring Judge Williams back, and Justice Sotomayor is going to come down to the audience and to, excuse me, take some questions from our students.
All right. So, throughout the audience, you're going to see these men and women dressed in suits with little things in their ears. They're my security force. Mostly they're trying to protect me from myself. But I will tell you that they get really upset if people jump up from their seats when I'm walking around, because they don't know what you're going to do. Even if it's to hug me, they're not sure. So please don't make them nervous, and as I walk around, jump up, okay? And I will hold your hand and talk to you, but don't make these poor guys turn their stomachs, okay?
And the other thing, just so you know, these 10 students have already been selected. This is not an open forum, so don't raise your hand and go, me, 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 me.
I am going to walk around. I would have moved these chairs closer, except I know they're filming this for overflow audiences. And I know the overflow is not going to see me as well. But I think it's so much better to connect with you as people if I'm down there. So the overflow will have to forgive me. And I hope you can hear clearly enough to understand what's going on.
And the one thing you should know before Justice Sotomayor came in here, she went to the overflow room in the speaking hall, I think the DCO hall, and then she spoke to, am I right? And then she came to the lobby and spoke to the students there, all the people who were there. And it's one of the most generous things I've ever seen anyone do here.
You're so sweet.
And it was just lovely. So have at it. So our first questioner, hi Rayvon.
Hi.
How are you? This is Rayvon Jones. She is from South Bend, Indiana. She is
Hello.
She is a senior, and she is a double major in sociology and Spanish.
Wow, that's quite an area of studies. Come, put the microphone down and let her take a picture. Now, I'm going to be listening to you. You can ask your question because I'm going to walk around, okay?
Awesome. Thank you so much. And thank you for being here.
The rest of you have to follow me, okay?
Yes. So my question is, as a woman of color myself, I know that women of color overcome unique obstacles that can kind of hinder our success at times. So what advice would you give to women of color who are working to achieve their aspirations? Thank you.
No, you have to work harder than anybody else. the expectations of you are very, very low. And people get very surprised when you meet those aspirations and exceed them. And it really feels really good when you do that. Right? One of the people during my confirmation process who had claimed that I was not good enough for the court, about a year and a half ago, issued a public apology and pointed to some of my decisions and said that he was wrong, that those decisions proved that he was wrong. That was exceedingly gratifying. And I've actually thanked him for it. But you do have to understand that. The other thing you have to understand is that people don't really understand their own prejudices. Most people do things that are discriminatory or say things that are hurtful without really knowing they're doing it. And I use an example from my book of the guy I was dating in high school, who they later became my husband, okay? I can't do that. Every day during the first month of our romance, he was bringing me a rose. And one day I take him to my aunt and uncle's house, who wasn't that, well, they lived not far from our high school. And he sat there completely mute. They were trying to be very nice to him. They brought out sodas and cookies and cakes, but they were mostly talking in Spanish. But they were trying in their broken English to communicate with him and engage with him. And he was silent. And I was furious. He went home, I went home, and I was about to break it off the next day. But instead of doing that, I went up to him and I decided to just ask him why he was so quiet and whether my aunt and uncle speaking Spanish was bothersome to him. And he looked at me very sheepishly and said, "Sonia, that's not what troubled me. You know that beautiful rose bush your uncle has in the front? The roses that I've been giving you every day come from that bush." I use that as an example because I jumped to a conclusion. And it was only by us talking about it that we avoided an unnecessary moment of tension. I might have lost the romance if I had not decided to ask why first. And that's something, an obstacle that I think you need to address, and perhaps in the way I'm suggesting, which is not to jump to conclusions, but to actually talk to people about the things you're feeling from them that might be negative. And when you call people on it, they often will sit down and have an honest conversation with you. Now, sometimes you might not like the response. I had a juror in a mock trial who I knew didn't like me. It was all over his face as I was talking. And I badgered him into telling me why he didn't like me. And what he said to me was, "It's something you can't do anything about." I said, "But I need to know so that I can figure out what to do as a lawyer in the future." And he looked and he said, "I don't like brassy Jewish women." And I stood there and in my mind was racing, what do I say to this man, you know? And what I realized was nothing. Because absolutely nothing I said to him would change his prejudice. And so I said, "You're right. I can't do anything about that." Now behind me was my Native American friend. And he said, "I was about to punch the guy out." I said, "Why bother?" My point is, that those small slights, those senses of not belonging, can make you not belong if you let them. You can belong and make friends in almost any place or setting you're in. But sometimes you have to make the effort to bridge that gap with people. I talk to all of my colleagues. I have relationships individually with all of them. And even though I am different than they are and can feel it, I try to share as much commonality as I can, which is what all of us people of color, and I've got friends who say they have more color than me, but any of us who are different in whatever ways we might be, you have to make an effort to bridge that gap too. And sometimes you have to work harder at it than the other people do. But it's worth it. You can make dear and lasting friendships that way. And you can succeed, I think, better by doing it. You'll reach your goals if you can manage to exalt your differences, but also exalt them. Everybody has their own life, and it all has value. You have to look for the value in the other side. Good luck in everything you're going to do.
Madeline Witt. Madeline's from Denver, Colorado.
I'm going to take a picture with you.
She's a senior here at Notre Dame. Her major is management consulting and international peace studies. Your question, Madeline? Where, wave, Sonia.
Your heart is beating hard. He's a kid. He got the picture. Come on up. Come.
Okay.
You can talk with that mic, can't you? Yeah.
Thank you very much for being here today and for sharing such an inspirational story with our Notre Dame community. My question is, how are you able to make decisions that affect the nation while keeping your personal views and preferences from swaying your ruling?
Thank you. Maybe I'll have a moment of education now, okay? Anne, which Anne? Anne Thompson was asking me about our differences and whether we are as political as the rest of the nation seems to be. Well, in some ways, the rest of the nation has looked to the judiciary to define their views. And by that I mean, there are judicial approaches to answering legal questions. The school that has now become associated with the right, because the right is talking the language of this judicial interpretation, is originalism, or original intent. And that was coined by my friend and colleague, Nino Scalia. And originalism basically says, you interpret the Constitution by looking at what it meant when the framers wrote the Constitution. There are people like me and others who think that that's a limited exercise because the founders didn't face many of the things we face today. During one oral argument on violent videos, my colleague Sam Alito, who is an originalist, by the way, by training and background, looked at the lawyer and said, do you think the founding fathers ever imagined that we would be able to recreate animations that look like people and committed heinous acts on film? And the lawyer looked up and said, well, I don't think so. And then my colleague, Justice Scalia, said, no, but they knew about horrible things. And so we'll treat this just like those other horrible things. Well, those are two different approaches to how you interpret the Constitution. Because one looks at what he could discern to be the meaning to the founders. that could be sometimes difficult because they weren't all of one mind. But he believes that by looking at the historical record, you can get the sense of what the meaning was about. There are those of us who think differently, that you have to look at history and how the Constitution has developed over time and how it's been interpreted so that you can then get a sense of what the provision means. And so even if the forefathers may have had a limited view, as people live through the centuries, that view may have expanded or narrowed depending on circumstances, and you apply it to the new circumstances that exist today, using the learnings of precedent and history throughout the nation's time. Those are really two fundamentally different ways of looking at things. Some people call the latter the active constitution. Justice Scalia used to call it the dead constitution, his approach. He's now changed. What's the word he's using? I've forgotten the word he's using because he realized dead was not a good thing. At any rate, what has happened to the political discussion, I believe, is that they've adopted these terms to promote outcomes that they think suit them. But I don't think that's how judges think. Judges need to be consistent. We have a need not to be arbitrary and capricious. Because if we are, it's very hard to live with yourself. If you think that you're just making judgments like God above and sort of deciding what's good or bad by your own druthers, it's a very uncomfortable position for most judges. We adopt approaches to interpretive principles to avoid that, to try to come to decisions that are consistent and approaches that are equal in each situation. And so it's not that we're political. I think the system has grown political around us. But our approaches can sometimes predict outcomes. If I know that who Justice Scalia is, that plain meaning of words is his mantra, and I am a contextualist instead, which is, I think that there's no plain meaning to any word standing alone. You look at the dictionary and most words have 1 to 15, 20 different meanings. What meaning you intend is based on context. So I look at every plain word to get its meaning from its context and its history. And that's how I come to my interpretations. But I can pretty much predict how he's going to rule on a lot of cases. Because to him, plain meaning is plain standing alone. He'll tell you he's a contextualist, but he's really not. So that's what I mean about, is it your personal preferences? No. It is much, much more your desire to reach outcomes that are by consistency and non-arbitrariness fair. The greatest injustice, I think, is when a judge lets their personal predilections determine a question. Because each time we determine a case, we've deigned a winner and we've announced a loser. And for me, the losers are half, most of the time, a point. They have an interest that's been harmed. They have a belief that's been hurt. And if I'm going to play God in that way, I think I'm going to make a lot more mistakes. And so it's easy because I believe in the system. I believe that if I practice judging in the way I've described, in a fair, objective approach, that that is what not only judging is about, but what fairness is about. You're welcome. you can follow me. I'm great. Thank you.
Justice, our next question comes from Alexander Lebedev. He comes from Island Park, New York. Are you a Yankees fan?
I am.
I'm sorry to hear that.
Oh, that's a good thing.
Alexander is a freshman. Did you ever think you would get to ask a Supreme Court justice a question in your first year at Notre Dame?
No, and definitely not in my second week here.
I'm glad they didn't promise you that. How's that?
Well, here's your opportunity.
Hi. Okay. Thanks so much, Justice Sotomayor, for being here. Hopefully I can speak for everyone in this room and say that we've all learned so much from you today. My question is, you know, as you touched upon earlier, it's really clear that some members of the court disagree with one another in very fundamental ways, and through opinions and zingers, they often sharply criticize one another. But personally, the nine justices seem to get along quite well, and in some cases, such as Justice Ginsburg and Justice Scalia, they're close friends. Can you comment on this and maybe speak a bit about how society as a whole can perhaps learn a lesson from this? Thank you.
You know, some of the questions we answer are pretty fundamental. You had an example of that this year. There's serious questions that affect the nation. And as I explained earlier, we're very passionate about the answers. All that you have to read is our exchanges in writing, and you know that we can get a bit excised. But what I told you before is that we do listen to each other. We disagree with each other, but we do listen. We try to persuade each other, we try to convince each other, and often we fail, and that's why you have dissent or don't. The don't is when we've succeeded. But that ability to accept difference for its own value is something that the rest of the country and the rest of our political system would do well to achieve. You know, it is hard to have friends who don't agree with you. It's not the easiest thing. Most of us have friends who are very similar to us in values and likes and things like that. The challenge is to make friends who don't agree with you, who try to talk you out of your mistakes, who try to change your mind. And whether they succeed or not is irrelevant. You learn something from them. And I think that that has value. It has value to learn from people who don't live the way you do and who don't think the things you think are important are. And I think the court shows that. And you're right. We're all exceedingly friendly with each other, despite our differences. And we can appreciate each other in a way that I think the larger society sometimes misses.
Sure. Thanks
so much. Learn how to forgive people who disagree with you.
Some of you may not know that earlier today, Justice Sotomayor was in the law school and spent time with the Latina law students, with a small group of students and faculty, and then with a huge group of law students in the main courtroom and also in an overflow courtroom. And Annie Nguyen is a first-year law student who didn't get a chance to ask a question earlier today. So now, Annie, the floor is yours. Annie is from San Jose and a first-year law student.
Thank you for being here tonight. My question to you is, what would you consider the most defining moment of your legal career and why?
I've been thinking about where's, okay. I don't know that there's ever one moment. There are a series of moments, and each moment where you make an important decision, like when I decided to go from being a district court judge to a circuit court judge. I think that decision probably led to the Supreme Court, because most of the recent appointments are all from the Court of Appeals. And no president yet, except President Obama, who picked a solicitor general, has broken that trend. He didn't pick a district court judge. So I think that was defining in terms of my career right now. But if you're talking about the moment in which I realized that I could be a lawyer, it happened one day in court. And it was my first year as a district attorney. And I was in court with a judge who was doing something that I thought violated the statute. And I looked at him and said, "Judge, the statute says you have to do this, but you want to do that. You can't do that." And he looked at me and he said, "I'm the judge, I can do what I want." It's not an answer I've given anybody since, okay? But he said, "So why should I do what the law said?" And I stood there, and this is before I was more sophisticated and understood the arguments better. And I thought to myself, he may have gotten you. And then all of a sudden the answer came to me. And I looked at him and I said, because the law is passed by the legislature, and that's a group of people who have studied this issue and come to a joint decision about what the answer should be. And that's why I think we have to follow it, because we can't just do what we want. Well, he did what he wanted. But at that moment, I knew that I could be a lawyer. That I could, even with hard questions, find something to say. Sometimes you have to admit when you're a lawyer, I don't have the answer. But you can know you're a lawyer at that moment where you haven't prepared for a situation that just happened, and the answer comes to you. And that's when I knew I would be both a trial lawyer, but a lawyer. I also knew I wanted to be a different kind of judge.
Danny Espinoza, come on down.
Danny, come this way. I'm walking up here.
Danny is from La Habra, California. He is a senior, and he too is a double major in international economics and political science.
Boy, those are tough subjects.
I'm muddling through.
Okay, I'm sure more than muddling. Go ahead.
Thank you for coming to speak with us tonight. And in keeping with your theme of humanizing the Supreme Court, I was wondering if you would describe a personal failure of yours that you view as motivated you to change or improve.
Well, this is giving vent to Anne. I do ask too many questions. I have to learn how to play in the sandbox better. But when there's nine people, it's really hard. And I've been working really hard at it. After that statistic came out that I was second to Justice Scalia, I have paid much closer attention to my questioning. And I think I have reduced it substantially. I'm now about fourth or fifth, which is not a bad place to be in the middle, okay? But I'm still trying to get better at it. I get so engrossed in argument. I get so engrossed in the back and forth of it that I sort of want to jump in and just engage it. And that is a personal failing, something that in a collegial atmosphere of a court of nine, you have to keep in check to be able to give everyone an opportunity to ask their questions. And so I'm still trying. If you want the biggest professional failure I've experienced, it was not getting a job offer after my second summer at the law firm. That may be the most humiliating moment of my life, professional life, because at the time I believed everybody got offers. It turns out in retrospect, not everybody, but almost everybody does. And I had to really look within myself to see why I didn't get an offer. And they were right. I hadn't figured out legal analysis sufficiently to have proven myself in that setting. And I knew that I wasn't quite ready. And so what I did after that in my small step way is that I figured out I had to go to a setting where legal writing might have been a little less important. That was the DA's office. But where I would get enough experience with arguing the law to understand legal writing better. And that really was the right choice for me at the DA's office. It helped me grapple with my weakness to give me enough confidence, enough of a sense of taking the risks that I then went and joined the law firm. But I couldn't have gone from that failure straight into a law firm because I hadn't grappled yet with my weakness enough to be able to find a way to correct it. And I think I bought myself the kind of time I needed in the DA's office to do it. Yes, there are people who live charmed lives and never have to face anything difficult. But that's not most of us. Most of us fail at something. Most of us can't do some things. It's just the human condition. We're not perfect. And you get hurt in life, just like I did in my Supreme Court nomination process. But I don't measure my character by how I respond inside. I measure my character by how many times I get up and try again. That tells people the strength of who you are, how much internal courage and fortitude you have. Because knocking down, you're going to be knocked down more often than you want. You just got to count the times you've gotten up and try it again. And don't give up. What have I given up on? Swimming. I'm a horrible swimmer. I've given up trying to sing. I can't sing. I've tried to take lessons in all these things. I can't dance, but I learned how to dance enough so that if I have a good partner, he can make me look okay. So sometimes you can't break the wall down, you just walk around it.
Our next questioner, Katrina. Here she is. And Katrina has read your book.
Ah.
Katrina Linden is from Santa Ana, California. She's a senior. Also a double major, American Studies and Latina Studies.
What's with these double majors? Are you like, you guys like working that hard? Hello, how are you?
Good.
If you're under 12 years old, come over here. Come on. You can ask your question. I'm only going to take a picture with them. Hello, you guys.
So I love your memoir.
Are you related or are you not related?
We're related.
Oh, okay.
So in your memoir, your mother's relationship with your family seems to have had an impact on the way you view your role as a working woman. What advice do you have for young independent women attempting to find a balance between personal successes and pleasing those around them?
You can't have it all. It's a myth. It's a myth that we all want to buy into as women, that you can do it all. Well, you can't do it all, because nobody humanly can do it all. You can't work 100 hours a week and think that you're going to be the perfect parent to your child. Because to work 100 hours a week, you're going to have to miss some things that are important to your child. I don't know a working mother who, when she's at work, is not wondering what her child is doing, and who's at home not wondering about the pile of work on their desk. That's the nature of being a professional woman. Is it a bad thing? Not necessarily. You do learn to balance, but not in the way you think. You don't have perfect days where you say, today, I'm going to be at work from 8 to 3 when my child is in school, and then I'll be home with my child, and work will be okay. Even teachers can't do that, because teachers have to go home and prepare lessons the next day, okay? What you have to accept is that life is a continuum, and that there will be days when you have to give more to work because you just have to. The emergency has cropped up. And there are days when work will have to sit back and wait because there really is a very special moment for your family that you have to participate in. And so it won't be equal every day, but it'll be equal in the flow of living this life and finding satisfaction in your two worlds in a way that will keep you happy and those who are a part of it happy with you. Part of it, though, is somehow engaging your family in what you're doing. You have to tell them the importance of what you're doing. You have to show them your happiness in doing it. Because if you're demonstrating that to them, most of them will be unselfish enough to understand your needs at work. But, you know, the parents that I have seen who have been the happiest with their children are the ones where the kids can actually talk to me and tell me what their parents do. And that tells me that they've been having conversations about what to do together. Don't despair. I don't think that it's a bad thing. I think that's what makes women so special, that we can do it, and that we do it elegantly in many situations. Anne Thompson, do you have any children?
I do not, no.
All right, but never. I know.
I have five nephews and a niece who are lights of my life.
And I have 7 godchildren. All right, but Anne Williams, you have how many?
I have 2 children.
2 children.
A son and a daughter.
And she raised them while she was a district court judge, a circuit court judge. Now they're grown up and out of the house, and as we were talking about today, she's able to buy different colored glasses for every outfit.
Justice Sotomayor, your next questioner is Juan Hernandez. He comes from Sacramento, California, and he too is a freshman. And if I could just brag on the class of 2019, it is the most academically accomplished class that Notre Dame has ever admitted, and it's also the most diverse class Notre Dame has ever admitted.
Father John, you have to be very happy with yourself.
Hi, thank you for coming tonight. My question is, being the first justice of Hispanic heritage, do you believe that the next Supreme Court justices should be people of color to better represent America's diverse population?
Not necessarily. I think that the greater ill on the court today is its lack of diversity professionally. To the extent that the Supreme Court is not reflecting the legal practice and the ways in which lawyers interact with the larger society in so many different ways, I think that does damage to our jurisprudence. We've got a bunch of lawyers on the court, none of them who has done criminal defense work. Few have done white-collar criminal defense cases, but none of them have done any serious criminal defense work. We've got all prosecutors. We have only one civil rights lawyer, Ruth Bader Ginsburg. We don't have anybody except one justice who has ever practiced alone. We have areas of practice that people have never experienced. Immigration law, family law. I could name dozens of areas of law where people are interacting with lawyers day in and day out. And my court has no understanding of that practice. But we're making decisions that affect every one of those areas of law. Almost every sitting, we have criminal law cases that affect both criminal defendants and the practice of criminal law. And without experience in those areas, my colleagues and I are ruling. I think that that's a greater danger, because to the extent that the bench reflects the diversity of professions within law, then we're going to represent a broader swath of the society as a whole. And so I think that diversity is worrying me more than any. I mean, people point out we are 6 Catholics and 3 Jews. That's not the majority of Americans. The majority of Americans are Protestants. We have no Protestant on the court. Religion is perhaps one of the most divisive questions in every society of the world. And we don't have diversity of religion on our court. These are issues that we have to look at. We've got 5 New Yorkers. Now, I'm eternally grateful that the president didn't listen to me. But I'm not the last New Yorker he appointed. He appointed Justice Kagan after me, okay? So I'm talking out of both sides of my mouth, because if he had listened to me, I wouldn't be on the court. But the reality is that we should have representatives from throughout the country. We had no Westerner on the court. These, I think, are deficits that are equally important to race and gender questions. I think we have to examine the court with more care, and our elective officials have to think about a balance that makes sense for everyone. And so I don't think that gender and race is unimportant, but I don't think it should be the sole characteristic. Buena suerte.
Thank you. Gracias.
Justice Sotomayor, our next questioner is from Illinois. And you know, I love Illinois. I've lived there all my professional life. This student, Kelly Kraft, is from Peru, Illinois, and she's a second-year law student.
Good evening, Justice Sotomayor. Thank you so much for being here at Notre Dame tonight. It's a pleasure to be here with you and see you this afternoon as well as tonight. It's really, truly, truly an honor to meet you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anne Thompson kind of asked my question already, so I'm going to kind of improvise a little bit.
You can.
Okay, great. Becoming a Supreme Court justice comes with a lot of scrutiny, a lot of controversy. One of the things that some people said was they worried that you may not look at the facts, that racial and gender bias may creep in too much to your decision making, and you would throw the facts out the door. What do you say to that kind of scrutiny?
All right. If you read my dissent in the affirmative action case, I hope that you will notice that the vast majority of my opinion was used in describing the court's precedent, its 200-year history in how it dealt with race issues. And I pointed to the facts and the holdings of about a dozen Supreme Court precedents. And I pointed to the ways in which my colleagues in the majority were not stating the complete facts, were twisting the holdings, and were misstating the background of those cases. So I didn't make personal statements, I made judicial statements. I read the cases, I pointed to the language in the cases, I pointed to what the court said it was holding, what it said it wasn't holding, and I pointed to how that case, the Schutte case, fell into the trajectory of law that the court had laid out. I then showed how the majority was changing that trajectory based on a different understanding than I thought those cases showed. We judges are made up of our human experiences. Each one of us is not just a Latina justice, or a Irish justice, or an Italian justice like Justice Scalia. Each one of us is made up of all of our life experiences. I'm a former prosecutor. I'm a former commercial defense lawyer. I am a former member of a variety of different boards. I am a person that's made up of all of these experiences that meld together to make a Sonia. But that Sonia is not defined by one thing. It's not defined by just me being a woman or me just being a woman Latina. It's defined by the whole complexity of everything I've learned as a person. Do I try to make sure that my biases don't creep into my decisions? Yes. I try to see when my decisions are being influenced by my personal experiences. We had a case not so long ago having to do with searches by the police when cell phones are taken from defendants. And one of my colleagues looked up at one of the lawyers and said, "Who in the world would have two cell phones except a drug dealer?" And I whispered to Justice Breyer, who sits next to me, I said, "The lawyer he's talking to." All right? Because government lawyers, me, have a government phone and a personal phone. Sure. All right? But this colleague had been out of the government so long, he didn't realize this. Okay. Bias and life experience limit your understandings in ways you don't understand. That's why we have nine people. So that when people say things like that, that we can go back and say, "Oh, that's not a fair point anymore." You know? But that's what happens in the conversation. The assumptions that people are making get challenged. They get talked about and they get exposed when they're there. So I don't think I'm really given permission to make judgments based on just being a Latina or just being a woman. I make judgments taking into account not only my life experiences, but those of my colleagues who are explaining them to me. So the process is not as simple as people want to think it is. It is much, much more complex and much, much more interactive than people understand it to be. So good luck to you.
Thank you very much.
Our next questioner is Sean Brady. He comes from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and he is a second-year law student.
Justice Sotomayor, thank you so much for being with us here today. And I think that this question is particularly relevant after what you said at the law school about asking yourself every night, what have I learned today? My question to you is, with what philosophy do you approach legal questions on the Supreme Court? And how has that changed over the course of your judicial and legal career?
That's a really... You see, I was asked during my nomination process what my judicial philosophy was. And I said, I don't have one. Okay? Because by saying you have a judicial philosophy, it almost suggests that you have an outcome you want to reach, and you have a way of reaching it. And so that's how you treat your cases. I have always tried to approach the law as a learning process, of one of understanding how other people have approached particular questions and which ones make sense and don't make sense. I think on the court over time, I've grown to understand that I'm not an adherent of the living Constitution, because I think that's a descriptor that's meaningless. But I am one who has always believed, and I talked in my nomination process about it, I believe very firmly in precedent, and precedent that has developed and shown us a way of approaching a legal question. Some of my colleagues don't. Justice Thomas has openly said that if precedent is wrong, he won't follow it. And he doesn't. That's his personal predilection. Justice Scalia says that he's different from Justice Thomas because he believes that precedent has to be given some importance in legal analysis. But despite that, he leans more like Justice Thomas to saying, most of the time, precedent was based on faulty reasoning, and I won't follow faulty reasoning. So it's a way for him to reject precedent. I'm a bit different. I think precedent sets up expectations in society. So if I have a judicial philosophy, it is that people really expect the law to have some fixed meaning that can give them some measure of comfort in their human relations. And so that level of comfort can and has to be upset sometimes. Brown versus Board of Education really threw everybody for a loop in this country. It upset all relationships. People of color here are here today because of that decision. And some may say that some of the recent decisions of the court might do that. But generally speaking, I think that if I talk about a judicial philosophy, it is one of trying to stay within the confines of the law as it has been developing. And I've done that more and more, and particularly on the Supreme Court, because I see it so important. I hope I've answered your question.
Thank you.
And now we've come to the final question of the evening. Julia Tambari from Seattle, Washington, a junior in marketing.
Justice Sotomayor, thank you so much for being here tonight. My question is, knowing that you went to Yale as a female student of color, and for those of us who are students for minorities at a prestigious university such as Notre Dame, what do you feel we should know about how to make the most of our college experience and education, given that we are a member of this population, and how can we make the most of this time?
Well, I wish I could tell you I have an answer just for this population. I don't. I have an answer for everybody sitting here. You're getting a liberal arts education. And that means that you should be learning about all the arts. And I use that as a figure of speech. You should be learning about the world. And to do that, you have to get out of your comfort zone and study things that you know nothing about. I'm talking now particularly to the freshmen because I think seniors, it may be too late for you, and juniors, you may have a little bit of time. But I think that there are some basic life subjects that you should take. You should take a religion course. Why? Because the greatest conflicts in the world today are based on religion. And all of you may be religious in your own religion, but unless you have an understanding of the basic tenets of all the religions of the world, of how they work and how people think they influence people, you really can't judge current events. You will be ignorant about the issues that face the country, about when to go to war or not, and the reasons why you do it and you don't do it. And those are critical things you should know about as a citizen. You should take an economics course, whether you're a management major or a major in any of the other skills like accounting and stuff. If you're a citizen, you should be able to pick up the newspaper and know what supply and demand mean, what bell curves mean, what all of these common terms that are used in the newspapers mean. And so you have to educate yourself on those things. You should be taking a sociology course, a philosophy course, a course in things that you know nothing about, just to become a better informed person. When you leave this university, you should have a working knowledge of all the things that affect the human condition. I said working. You don't have to be an expert. You're going to have to major in something and even minor in it. But you should use this opportunity to learn about the things that you don't know, because that's what college is about. And so if you want to squeeze the opportunity of this school, do that. But that also means learning about activities that you wouldn't ordinarily become a part of. You know, go sit in on one of the debate clubs. Go sit in on a club that you know nothing about. Watch one of their, go in and just sit and listen to them talk one afternoon. Go in and meet people that you know nothing about from all parts of the country. Actually talk to them about their lives. I remember having a friend from Oregon who pined all 4 years to go back to Oregon. And he would talk about its beautiful blue skies and its landscapes, and he would paint pictures for me that made it so important for me to go out there and see that country one day. And I finally did. But that's what you should be learning about. You should be talking to people who are different than you and ask them about their lives, about their struggles, about the challenges their families have faced, the challenges they face, about the insecurities they feel, and about the joy of things that are important to them. Those are things that may teach you to like things that you may never have thought you'd like. I took an introductory art course, and, you know, I can't paint to save my life, but I can actually walk through a museum and identify some of the pieces and what major period they were from. That makes me feel at least semi-intelligent, all right? And then I get a tour guide to tell me more. But my point is that the value of this place to you should be the new things you learn every day. And to do that, don't get stuck in the rut of the things you think you like. Reach further. Go out and look for things that are different and try to experience a little bit of them. Maybe one of them will bite you and give you a bug and change your mind about your career. Maybe not, but it won't be lost time because it'll enrich you in immeasurable ways. Have fun here. Okay? Good luck to all of you.
So I know all of you will agree with me that that was most extraordinary. The students are most extraordinary, but you will never see a justice do that again unless she comes back. Should we have her come back? Yeah. And finally this evening, Justice, you work with the homeless. You are a supporter of the Bronx Children's Museum. You helped create an international training institute in Puerto Rico. Can you talk about what you want your legacy to be?
You know those kids under 12 I took pictures with? I will be alive in history until the day they die if they remember me. And if they remember me and talk to their children about something I said, I'll live the life of their children. My legacy, if I have one, I can't predict what it will be as a justice. I don't pick the cases. I don't pick the positions I want to take. Those develop. But what I can pick is how I spend my life as a justice. I'm here because you're important to me. You will make a better world. And so to the extent I can inspire any of you to do something more, to do something different, then that's my legacy to you. And you will keep me alive in history as long as you remember. And so if you ever get to a place that's special to you, and I had any small part in it, write and tell me, okay?
So you have all made that heart connection with the justice, and you see how she's triumphed in dreaming impossible dreams, and they have come true. And so in the way that I like to thank people, I would like to close by singing a song to the justice, The Impossible Dream, and I've changed the words for Justice Sotomayor. To dream the impossible dream, to fight the unbeatable foe, to bear with unbearable sorrow, to run where the brave dare not go, to right the unrightable wrong, to love pure and chaste from afar, to try when her arms are too weary, to reach the unreachable star. This is her quest, to follow that star, no matter how hopeless, no matter how far, to fight for the right without question or pause, to be willing to march into hell for a heavenly cause. And we know that she'll always be true to this glorious quest, that her heart will lie peaceful and calm when she ever does rest. And the world, it is better for this, that one woman, scorned and covered with scars, she still strives with her last ounce of courage to reach the unreachable
talk about a tough act to follow. I'm not gonna sing, but I just, on behalf of all of us, want to thank you for sharing your wonderful knowledge, wisdom, and warmth with us here at Notre Dame. As you can see, it means the world to us. We know that you are a Yankees fan and one of the great icons in all of sports. You're here at another great tradition. We have a football game this weekend, but we're thinking you're a baseball fan, and we hope that you always will feel a part of Notre Dame. We hope that you'll come back and join us, and we hope that you will wear our colors with pride.
That was just so wonderful. I can't thank you.
I'm going to watch Saturday night. We better win Fighting Irish.